The topic of this session is very common, and it's a very general discriminatory practice in almost all the societies of the world. Okay, and going by this, class system is also one of the social discriminatory practices in India as well. Okay. So we refer to it as both social class and also class system. Okay. So how do we understand the term class system in Indian cultural context? Okay. Here, elsewhere in the world as well, and here also in India, the class basically is defined by the amount of money, the amount of assets, the amount of property, basically any kind of belonging you have or you possess. Okay, basically it is the defining and deciding quotient of how rich or poor you are. Okay, so that is very, in a layman's language, is known as class system. Okay, so when we say class, going by the commonsensical knowledge and division of society, and when we say division, it comes under the small chunk in your syllabus of I think the second unit, called social stratification. Okay, social stratification, that means the way society is divided and stratified into different categories, into different units, different groups, and different communities. Okay, so social class is one such unit. So how do we understand the types under a class system? We divide it generally, as I said, going by your common knowledge, that it is divided as the upper class, the middle class, and the lower class. There is some kind of blurred margin between upper and middle class. Okay, the fourth category, which is generally not there most of the times, but it does exist, because people who are not very rich and who are who feel kind of embarrassed to be called as middle class, they would like to they prefer, and they would like to be addressed as upper middle class. Okay, upper middle class. So that's another small or fourth category under class system. Okay, then if you go by the theory of class system, you can go back to the famous sociologist and as well as the famous economist, the Russian sociologist and economist called Karl Marx. Okay, Karl Marx, he propounded a theory which was named after him as a Marxist theory. Okay, so according to this theory, he happens to divide society into three social classes. Okay, and he divided it as base, structure, and superstructure. Okay, base is a direct parallel to the lower class, and the structure is a direct parallel to the middle class, and superstructure is a direct parallel to the upper class, okay, or the rich class. Okay, so generally in India especially, we refer it to as lower class, middle class, upper class. But Karl Marx happened to divide it into more strategic manner, in a more academic fashion, as base, structure, and superstructure. So why did he name like this? Why did he name these classes as such? The reason behind is that he calls base as the kind of refers to the social strata where you have people like this daily laborers, daily wage workers, the servants, the domestic help and attenders and sweepers, then cleaners, all kind of people who do some who are engaged in physical labor and do very menial jobs, and they are usually looked down upon, and they are downtrodden classes of society who usually bear the brunt of other two classes of society. Okay, they are the most burdened people. They lie at the bottom level of hierarchy. That is why they are known as people who belong to the base category, who are at the bottom, the base. Okay, so the second category is structure, which is a direct parallel with middle class. Okay, where you have a little professional people, right, like the clerks, the office attendants, the accountants, then even teachers, professors, then you have any kind of people who are involved in clerical jobs, right, who belong to this typical 9-to-5 job category, who work for others, basically the employees who work for their other rich employers. Okay, so generally known as the white collar jobs, sometimes even blue collar jobs. So these people, they come under the middle category structure. They basically help in formulating the structure of society, of its economy, and where generally the society is leading to. And this category of structure, this forms majority of the population of a nation or a country. Okay, so another category Karl Marx comes out is famously known as superstructure. Okay, superstructure includes people who are in some authoritative positions, right? So people who are responsible for making up and deciding the rules and laws of society and making up of the work environment for others, and people who take decisions for others, right, who decide how things have to be run in a particular society or a country. Okay, so these people fall under the category of superstructure. So you can include all kinds of authorities, like the employers who own institutions, who own companies, who own factories, who own industries, okay, and also the political figures, okay, who are in charge of ruling and running the country. Basically it involves people who rule, who dictate terms to others, right, who are supposed to be very corrupt and very rich people. Can't generalize that all of them are corrupt as such, but basically they are very rich people, right, who give employment to others, who hire others, who offer jobs to others, who are in powerful and controlling position of the society. So these people, they fall under the category of superstructure. Okay, so we can further go on with other multiple examples under the same category, class system. Okay, and in fact Karl Marx is one of the first economists and the first person indeed to describe such a system called class system. Okay, and he gave this unique name to this system as well. Okay, so in class system, people set apart by what they do for living and how they do it. Okay, and that's exactly what defines to which class they belong to. Okay, and keeping that in mind, we find managers, professionals, doctors, lawyers, clergy placed together in a similar class. Maybe people who form the structure of the society, the middle category. Okay, so then you have people who earn their living for by infusing efforts are defined as working class. This class forms the base of the society, like carpenters, plumbers, truck drivers, then mechanics, then loggers, then assembly line workers, and the list goes on. Okay, and the first category, what we said, professional, doctors, lawyers, clergy, sometimes these come under not exactly structure or middle class, but superstructure. Because when you say doctors, lawyers, they can own their own institutions and companies, right? So even the clergy have upper hand in religious institutions like church. So they belong to superstructure. The plumbers, carpenters, truck drivers, mechanics, these belong to the base level of the society. Okay, and you have people between these two extremes. There is another group called managers, workers, okay, and is a large group of lower white collar workers. Okay, as you are describing, white collar and blue collar, they belong to lower white collar category, right? And it also involves clerks, salespeople, teachers, draftsmen, okay, then computer technicians, and the list goes on. Then you have another few more examples for the lowest level, the base level of people in society, like daily laborers, drug dealers, prostitutes, petty thieves, and other criminals. Okay, and finally, going by these examples, we can say that there are three major classes: the upper class and the individuals that are at the top who control the means of production in the society and who make rules. Okay, then there is middle class, we saw the examples of them, and also the base level and the examples for that as well. Okay, but the interesting part is that under class system, it is a open system. Why do we call it as open system? Because class system could be changed. The position of a person in a society going by one's class can be modified. Okay, for example, today if a person is a carpenter, for example, his son or daughter might have some startup business, might for example do some fashion designing course and do some startup business in fashion industry, and one fine day, maybe after 10 years, own an institution of fashion design of his or her own, then that particular son or daughter of a carpenter has crisscrossed the boundaries of class system, and that person has plunged, he or she has jumped from belonging to middle class to the upper class, right? From being part of structure to the superstructure. So this is how class system can be an open class compared to caste system, which is by birth, which is a closed system. Irrespective of how rich you become or how economically well refined you become, you still belong to the same caste because you are born in it. It has religious affinity, right? Caste system. So you are born in it and you continue to belong there. Okay, so keeping that in mind, the only positive aspect of class system is that it is open-ended. It could be modified at any point in your life either with your efforts or other people's support, encouragement, okay, or kind of justice could be got in this system, irrespective of the kind of evil and discriminatory practices meted out so far. Everywhere you find the examples, right, of these discriminatory practices under social stratifying categories like class system, okay, but still it is a kind of open system, okay. So compared to caste, class is a better way in a way, okay. And basically class system, to which class you belong to, is judged and evaluated on the basis of income first, and your earning, basic earning and income, secondly by the wealth you possess. It could also be the wealth you possess or the income you earn, okay. So these are the two deciding categories to tell to which class you belong to in society, okay. Then there are something called there is this concept of estate, and based on estates are nothing but based on land and loyalty to an entity, based on these categories estates are decided, okay. And under these estates again you have three predominant categories, okay. The first category is the landed gentry, nobility, people who possess large amount of land and make the decisions. And these people used to make decisions for others and ran things for others, okay. And these people are supposed to belong to the uppermost class of society, okay. And the second category under estates is the clergy people who perform religious ceremonies in the Christian church, okay. So this is the second estate. Then comes the last category under these estates, the serfs or peasantry people, okay, who are forced to live and work on land, okay, that belong to a landowner whom they had to obey. And the goods and services, okay, they provide goods and services for gentry and clergy class, okay. Based on these three estates, you also have this concept where you have serfdom and peasants, right? People who, the poor people who work on the lands of others. It's almost like, what we know as the bonded labor, right? The serfdom and peasantry, wherein you got to work for other people. You provide them sometimes even the finished goods, and also sometimes services. You end up not only working on their lands, you also end up working in their fields and gardens, and you also end up working at a home, okay, their homes, the gentry class and nobility classes homes, okay. And you provide any kind of service to them, okay, either being a sweeper at their place, cook at a place, taking care of their children, driving their cars, okay. It could be any kind of service. So people can belong to the social classes based on three estates as well, okay. The gentry and nobility class, then you have a middle class, which has parallel with clergy, people who kind of give service in the church, the religious heads, okay. Because when you say religious heads, many times it happens so that they need to be, they of course have scholarship, right, they are learned people. They can't belong to the lowest category, work category of a society, but at the same time, many times it so happens that they need some patron. They need rich people to patronize their needs, to keep them, to kind of provide them financial assistance and security. So keeping this in mind, these clergy class, they share parallel with middle class. Okay, having scholars, they have scholarship, but they need financial assistance. Okay, so this is how you see that the class system is divided. Generally, in any society or in any country, and also it is the case with Indian cultural scenario as well.